For the past 500 years, few places have stirred the imagination more than a beautiful and mysterious building in Scotland called Rosslyn Chapel. Some legends claim it has links with secretive organisations such as the Freemasons or the Knights Templar. One extravagant theory even suggests that buried within the chapel is the Holy Grail of Christ. Whatever the truth of these claims, over the centuries, countless writers and artists have found inspiration in the extraordinary stone carvings here at Rosslyn. Once described as a poem of stone powdered with stars. My name's Helen Rosslyn, and the chapel's been in my husband's family since it was built. As an art historian, I'm fascinated by the stories behind works of art. To solve some of Rosslyn's mysteries and to reveal the meanings behind these carvings, I'm going to get closer to the stonework than anyone has in years. I'll visit sites across Scotland to learn more about the art of medieval stonemasonry. And I'll also travel to the continent to search for the Norman origins of the men who built Rosslyn Chapel and what inspired them to create such a remarkable treasure in stone. Rosslyn Chapel's greatest attraction is the extraordinary beauty of its stonework. Many of these inspiring carvings are religious narratives, yet the meaning behind some of them has been forgotten. And very little is known about the medieval stonemasons who created them. Just what influenced these largely forgotten artists to cover the chapel with so many intricate carvings is shrouded in mystery. Rosslyn Chapel lies about 8 miles south of Edinburgh. It was built as a family chapel in the middle of the 15th century by Sir William St. Clair, 11th Baron of Rosslyn and Prince of Orkney. By the 17th century, the chapel had fallen into ruins. But in 2003, it became famous worldwide when it featured prominently in the Da Vinci Code. I always love coming into this chapel because I'm absolutely amazed by the carving. It's on every single surface, which sort of makes you feel as though you're stepping right into a three-dimensional medieval sculpture. It's been called the Bible in stone, which is hardly surprising because it is a chapel. And one of the really interesting things about the carvings is that they would have been done in an age when people couldn't really read. And so a lot of the moral stories, like this one here, were done in stone to remind people of how they should behave. And here we've got the seven virtues, and on the other side of the same flat arch, we've got the seven deadly sins. You can see a man standing, deciding whether he's going to follow the virtues and end up with St. Peter at the gates of heaven. And the things he has to do, the seven virtues, are helping the needy, clothing the naked, and then you've got visiting the sick, with a bed and a sick person in it. And then after that, you've got visiting those in prison. And that's incredible, the detail there. If you look really carefully, you can even see a face behind bars in the prison. And then there is feeding the hungry and burying the dead. And the reward is St. Peter standing with a key at the gates of heaven. On the other side, we have the seven deadly sins. You have pride, gluttony, anger there with the man and his axe. Now, the most interesting thing for me about this is that one of the stones is the wrong way round. This could have been just a simple human error, but you can see that charity there with the two figures is the wrong way round amongst the seven deadly sins, and on the other side, you've got greed or avarice amongst the virtues. So it was probably just the simple case of human error. The poor stonemason who carved the wrong scene on the wrong side of the stone had to put it in anyway because it would only fit one way round, and he just hoped nobody would notice. Virtually every surface tells a different moral tale. One of the hidden gems in this chapel is this stone depiction of the Dance of Death, which was also often called the Danse Macabre, because it came really from France, and it reflects the medieval preoccupation with mortality. Each of the figures here, taken from different walks of life, is shown with a skeleton to indicate that death always wins out in the end. But many of Rosslyn's medieval carvings have been covered by modern scaffolding for over a decade. The chapel's been undergoing a £9 million conservation programme. In the aftermath of the Reformation, Rosslyn fell into disrepair. But by the late 18th century, the romantic, overgrown ruins had become an inspiration for artists like David Roberts and Turner, as well as writers like Wordsworth, Burns, and Sir Walter Scott. Although there were some early attempts to restore and repair the place, centuries of foul Scottish weather caused severe damage. So for the past 13 years, we've been trying to dry it out by covering it with this 50-ton steel roof. As the Countess of Rosslyn and the chairman of the Rosslyn Chapel Trust, I've been closely involved with the conservation programme.
When I first came here nearly 30 years ago, the stone was so saturated that water was literally running down the inside of the chapel walls. So it was clear we had to do something quite dramatic to make the building watertight. The first thing we did was to put on this protective canopy. And the second phase, which we're doing at the moment, is to fix the roof, the leaky windows, and the rather eccentric medieval drainage system. So that's why this building is such a hive of activity, because in the next couple of months, hopefully, the canopy is about to come off.
The latest conservation techniques focus on preserving as much of the detail of the original stonework as possible and learning from some of the mistakes of the past. In the 1950s, the walls were so damp that a decision was taken to clean the internal stonework and coat it with magnesium fluoride, also known as cementitious slurry. Done with the best of intentions, it had the unforeseen consequence of obscuring much of the original detail. The man in charge of the conservation team, Nick Boys, has unearthed some old footage of the unfortunate process going on.
All right, what I'm really keen to show you now is work that was done during the 1950s by the Ministry of Works. Okay, so we're really focusing on the interior of the chapel.
So this is the application of the cementitious slurry that we always hear about, is it?
Well, yes, it is the application of the surface treatment. Here you can see we've got a man. He's actually cleaning there, I think. So what he's got is a small paintbrush, and this is very similar to the work that we were doing.
Yes.
Now we have this guy who's happy in his work. Is applying, and you can see just how he's doing it. He's using a 3-inch paintbrush and he's stippling the material on. And that's exactly the material that we can see now.
Right. That white stuff, really.
Yeah. This is the moment when the surface of the stone, as we were intended to view it by the carver, is overpainted. And so there's a fantastic view of that angel figure.
Without the coating on it.
Without the coating on it. And you can just see just how crisp, just how legible that carved detail is. So then, that's beautifully smartened and, you know...
But the thinking behind it, presumably, was that they would just stop the stone crumbling.
That was
really what prompted them to do it?
That was part of it. OK, so they were responding to a decayed stone surface, mm-hmm. but they were also responding to the fact that they obviously could see that there was water coming in through the building. And also, there was this really sort of unpleasant visual result of that. OK, so there would be dead biological growth, it'd be live biological growth, it would have been blotchy.
So really, they would have applied several layers of this thing, would they? Which is why it looks so thick and why there's so much of the detail of the carvings lost.
Exactly, yeah. In fact, when we're going to have a close look at it, you can actually still see the brush marks. You can see just how thickly it's been applied.
In an attempt to reveal the detail of the original carvings, Nick and his team have done some tests to remove the magnesium fluoride. But unfortunately, the techniques available at the moment risk damaging the stonework even more. I'm now very aware of our responsibility to ensure that the conservation techniques we choose will not prove someday to cause more harm than good. For the conservation work, we haven't just had scaffolding on the outside of the chapel, we've had it on the inside as well. It might be a temporary disappointment for visitors, but it allows us to get a close-up look at the astonishing stonework of the chapel's medieval masons.
Let's have a look at this.
Oh, yes, look. So much detail. I mean, all that carving on the cuff there, and these fingernails. I mean, it matches the one on the other side, doesn't it? Which is superb.
I mean, we are more than 35 feet from the ground here, so you can imagine that none of this was, you know, was carved with the intention of being viewed closely.
No, I think that's what's so astounding. And yet, they just haven't spared any detail at all. I mean, even above the cross there, you've got that little bit of detailed engraving.
And of course, we've seen the footage taken during the 1950s of the man exactly here, using a paintbrush to remove loose material from each of these...
From these flowers?
Yeah, from these flower motifs.
I've never seen that before.
Of course,
the way all these ribs are completely different. I mean, the decoration on this is completely different from the decoration on that and the one at the end, look. What else is there in this bay? I love the different carving here. Oh, look, there is another face. And that's a really different face. Look, it's a really sort of calm, serene face, but quite plain. That's quite interesting.
It's very enigmatic, isn't it?
Yeah,
it is. Right, but what's particularly interesting to me, just emerging there, is an oyster shell.
Oh, really?
Right, which is it's a really well-known sort of construction technique of the 15th century, to pack construction joints with oyster shells.
I can really see it well, actually.
And that, the reason for that is that it reduces the mass of mortar. And we still do that nowadays. I mean, for example, we've been working on the outside of this roof, doing exactly the same thing, albeit with a different material.
And look at this level. This is a great level, actually, because you get the light coming in so beautifully from the windows. It's lovely to be able to get a chance to see some of this detail. I mean, this must be one of the tops of the niches of the statues. And, I mean, I've never noticed that it was so incredibly detailed, all this carving.
Precisely. Beautiful chevron detail.
Isn't it?
Yeah, is virtually invisible from down below. If you can see that there are these ball flower motifs, and they are beautifully spaced, and there's an exquisite rhythm to them, all the way up until you get to this construction joint. And there you can see that somebody's made a small error.
But for me, that's the charm of this building, because it's just its individuality.
Yeah.
And then, just above it, is Christ with his hand raised in blessing, which I've seen from down below, but I've never managed to see here. And again, just like up above, you've even got the detail on his cuff, which I haven't seen before. So it's probably fair to say that with the exception of the 1950s workmen, probably the only other people who would have seen this carving in this place are the masons who put it there.
Yes, that is entirely possible.
This is a really fascinating carving with three heads. And they're so detailed again, but they're really different heads. That's what's so interesting. So this here with the long hair probably signifies somebody of nobility, I would think.
All I can say is the one on the left is certainly happy about his work.
These carvings are an impressive display of masonry and artistic skills. Unfortunately, we know almost nothing about the men who created them. To find out more about the origins of the chapel and the men who built it, I'm heading up the road to Edinburgh. Historians agree that Rosslyn Chapel was founded in 1446 by Sir William St. Clair, the 11th Baron of Rosslyn. But all his original papers were destroyed in a fire. Here at the National Library of Scotland, I've come to see historical documents expert Julian Russell.
Yes, well, it's very interesting.
He's the leading authority on a manuscript previously copied from the original 15th century accounts of Sir William St. Clair. It was completed in 1700 by a cleric called Father Richard Hay.
And Father Hay was so closely associated with the family, wasn't he? Because I know he married in... his mother married.
His mother, yes. His father died when he was a schoolboy. His mother married again, and she married a member of the St. Clair family.
And here he is, William St. Clair, Prince of Orkney. Oh, yes, here we are, velvet, chains of gold. It came in his mind to build a house for God's service of most curious work. The foundation of this
rare
work he caused to be laid in the year of our Lord, 1446. And because he thought the masons had not a convenient place to lodge in near the place where he builded this curious college, therefore, he made them to build the town of Rosslyn that now is extant, and gave every one of them a house and lands.
Answerable thereunto.
Answerable thereunto.
So that this town, at that time, became very populous, so that it was thought to be the chiefest town in all Lothian, except Edinburgh and Haddington.
So that's rather a lovely image, isn't it? The idea of Sir William St. Clair creating this great town for his masons.
It's rather surprising because yes. You don't think of Rosslyn as being, such an important place.
I wondered about what they'd been paid. He rewarded the masons according to their degree. As to the master mason, he gave £40 yearly, and to every one of the rest, £10.
£10 in 1446 equates to something approaching £50,000 today. So the master mason's wage of £40 was a massive amount. These masons, whoever they were obviously highly valued by Sir William. But how did he come to have that kind of wealth and status? In the year 1066, the first St. Clairs came to Britain from Normandy with their cousin William the Conqueror. But when a later descendant of the St. Clairs, William the Seemly, helped an Anglo-Saxon princess to escape north of the English border, the King of Scotland rewarded him with the lands of Rosslyn. Remains of the St. Clair's castle can still be found today, close to Rosslyn Chapel.
From this bridge, you really do get an idea of the scale and grandeur of the building as it would have been in Sir William St. Clair's day. Starting right down there by the river, it would have been a real medieval stronghold. It was apparently built on three sides of this courtyard here, with a large tower in the far corner and a really imposing gatehouse at the edge of the bridge. So although it doesn't look like much today, in the 15th century, it would have been one of the most imposing castles in Scotland.
The castle was started more than a century before the chapel, and work continued on it throughout the Hundred Years' War, a conflict in which the Scots supported the French. This close association between Scotland and France led the lifestyles of some Scottish nobles to become increasingly cosmopolitan. The St. Clairs enjoyed a lavish way of life with continental tastes and had their pick of the finest wines imported from Bordeaux. Today, parts of the castle still have a strongly medieval feel to them. The lower floors haven't been touched for centuries, and frankly, I must admit they look like it. It's hard to imagine these walls were once covered by rich tapestries and the rooms filled with exquisite furniture. Sadly, these rooms have become little more than damp dungeons. Yet they must once have been the scenes of great banquets and sumptuous living. When Sir William Sinclair inherited the title in 1420, he used his vast wealth to expand the castle. He hired teams of masons to build new stone walls and bridges. But he dreamt of building a completely new and special place, a site of extraordinary, inspirational carvings that would be unique to Scotland. He started making plans for the construction of Rosslyn Chapel. I often hear people comment on the modest size of the chapel, given its massive worldwide fame. Modest or not, it still took 40 years to build. But sadly, Sir William died before he could complete his ambitious architectural vision. It was a common belief amongst wealthy nobles that building a private church would be rewarded by God with a passport to heaven. Before long, a rather serious game of one-upmanship had begun, with each noble trying to outbuild the other. Sir William certainly had no intention of being outdone by anyone. His original plan was to build a much more substantial Rosslyn church, double the length of the current chapel, and there are several clues to be found in the existing building.
The evidence is that we've got this sort of external feature, this string course. Mm. Okay, and this has a job to do. I mean, this part of the role of this piece of stone is to protect the foot of the wall from rainwater that will inevitably run down this external wall, okay? But if you look on the other side, of course, the string course isn't there. There's no need for it. So this is an external feature. And it's really charming to see that. It's almost as though the mason has kind of just gone off for his lunch. So what you've got is this lovely profile continuing along here, and then it begins to return. So there's the joint.
So it does, a nice little corner.
Yeah, and then it's going to come along out that way. But of course, it never got built. You know, it never, ever got that far.
So one of the obvious differences then is some of these details here, that, and then those niches, I suppose, that would have been on the inside then if this had been the wall.
Precisely. There's nothing above that element. No. To protect it from rainwater, because it was never envisaged that it would be exposed to the weather.
No, of course. So if we progress down this wall, we've actually got this piece here, which was presumably where the aisle went.
It was always envisaged then that the aisle would have continued through here, mm-hmm. and we'd now be standing pretty much at the edge of the tower that was planned. So an enormous tower was planned, one that could have been visible from Edinburgh, so it's written, and it would have just gone whoosh from here.
Yes, that would have been a very impressive bit of building.
The foundation stones of the bigger building extended 34 metres beyond the chapel.
So this is the original construction, so this is the original wall here. Mm-hmm. So what we're going to do is we're going to pace out that way.
Oh, yes. Right. I'll take my lead from you.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34. metres, and this is as far as the chapel was expected to extend.
Oh, I see. I've never thought to work that out.
But even though the chapel was never completed, what it lacks in scale, it more than makes up for in beauty and architectural significance. There are numerous theories about what inspired the design of Rosslyn Chapel. Some suggest that it was built as a smaller version of the ancient Temple of Solomon in Jerusalem. But I just wonder if the truth might lie much closer to home. I've come west to visit Glasgow Cathedral. I've never been here before, but the design of the cathedral's choir, built a couple of hundred years before Rosslyn Chapel, is said to be very similar. I've asked Brian Park, Rosslyn's conservation architect, to show me around. As we walk into the choir section, I can hardly believe what I see before me.
Look at this. It is extraordinary. Now you really get that sense. The layout's absolutely the same, isn't it? But what's so extraordinary, it has such a different effect. Soaring to the heavens.
Indeed. Yeah.
Which is not really the effect of Rosslyn.
The scale and section is quite different. Well, proportionately, the plan is very similar.
The similarity between the rather dark choir area here at Glasgow and the whitewashed chapel back at Rosslyn is striking. There is exactly the same number of pillars, and they are in exactly the same arrangement.
So it's quite interesting to think then that this would started, 200, 100 years before Rosslyn?
Probably closer to 200 years before Rosslyn.
Yes.
Much of Glasgow Cathedral was back to the 13th century, and certainly the choir here would have been extant at the time when Rosslyn was being constructed. Mm.
So this is a great place to stand and get a real vision of what Sir William must have had in mind. I mean, it was a hugely ambitious vision he must have had. He wanted to create something this size.
Hugely ambitious. And if we were standing in Rosslyn and had Sir William built the whole thing, we would be looking at a similar view. So at Rosslyn, we would be looking now at the organ gallery, whereas if the nave had been built, we would have a similar view to here. Slightly different scale, but that sense of running right through to the nave in a fantastic west window.
Whereas what we actually have is a wall at the level of that balcony there.
That's right.
Seeing this, it seems highly likely that Sir William was influenced by this cathedral when he designed Rosslyn Chapel. After all, in Sir William's day, Glasgow was only a two-day horse ride from Rosslyn. But he didn't set out just to build a replica of Glasgow Cathedral. His plans were far more ambitious than that. Sir William got his stonemasons to cover every single surface of his chapel with exquisite carvings. It's this abundance of sculptures and designs that really sets Rosslyn Chapel apart from almost any other building in the world. Everywhere you look, inside and out, are carved images upon carved images. As one might expect in a family chapel, there are several carvings that relate to the St. Clares. Almost hidden from view at the back of the building is a carving of the chapel's founder, Sir William. Building Rosslyn also gave him the chance to honour the important achievements of his ancestors. Another carving depicts the first St. Clare to settle in Britain, William the Seemly, on his horse, escorting the Anglo-Saxon Princess Margaret to Scotland. But the meanings behind some of the chapel's carvings are far from clear. In amongst images of plants and animals, there are strange mutant figures of mysterious so-called green men. Some of the plant-like carvings may have been inspired by the drawings found in the margins of medieval illuminated manuscripts.
In a chapel, you might expect to find biblical stories or moral tales, but one of the lovely things about this place is that it's absolutely bursting with plant imagery. Flowers, leaves, and here is a really good example. This string course that frames the windows has got, in amongst the leaves, a green man's face. The green man is a face with leaves traditionally coming out of its mouth and blending into a bed of foliage behind. And whilst they're not very common in buildings in Scotland, we have over 100 here at Rosslyn.
There are many theories about the origins of green men. Some say they are old pagan symbols representing nature and rebirth. Others say they are Christian images that represented man's sinful origins in nature. It is quite incredible to think that the Rosslyn stonemasons created each of these carvings from rough blocks of shapeless sandstone. It took about 10,000 such stones to construct Rosslyn Chapel, and extracting them from the medieval quarries would have been no small feat. To find out how the stonemasons acquired their rocks, I'm paying a visit to Marcus Payne, director of the Hutton Stone Company. He runs one of the last active quarries in Scotland, just 30 miles from Rosslyn.
There is quite a variation in colour in here, from buff to a sort of bluey-grey.
So obviously you've got this modern machinery here, but is the process more or less the same, or is it really highly developed?
The process is virtually the same. Mm. The large excavator replaces many men and really is nothing more than a very large crowbar. The actual process of working several layers back at a time, mm-hmm. so you reveal the top bed of each stone,
oh, yes,
so that you can find the natural faults, is exactly the same.
Today, the stone is split using a pneumatic drill. But in the 15th century, it all had to be done manually.
We're going to split a block by hand to show you how they would have done it.
Well, that's really interesting.
Yeah, the only thing we won't do, they used to split them with wooden wedges, but they would soak them in water and leave them for days, and I don't think we've got time to do that.
No, well, fair enough.
So this is how it's been split out for many, many years. As he goes along the pins, he's listening to hear each pin tension up so that they all begin to ring at the same tension, which means the tension is even, so the split is controlled. You can hear them starting to... There you go.
He can hear when
it's you can start to see the split is starting to come along. But you can tell which ones are doing the work now.
And there's
just that ring, and also you can feel it in the handle of the hammer.
There it is.
So it's doing more work.
So exciting for you then when you find a piece that you consider is going to be a good piece of stone, is it?
A really big special piece. To be honest, we never tire of finding really fantastic pieces of stone. You know, sometimes we might find a piece of stone here 5 metres long, and that's just a fantastic thing for us. We're still childish enough to get excited about that.
I can understand it actually when you see the process there.
It would have taken dozens of men several years to produce enough stones for Rosslyn Chapel. Today, it would take a few men just a month. But getting the rock out of the ground is only the first step. The rocks then need to be cut into neatly shaped stones before they can be sent to the stonemasons for carving. As winter turns to spring, the conservation work at Rosslyn picks up pace, and I've got a chance to see some of the modern stonemason skills in practice. The emphasis at Rosslyn is on preserving the existing stone carvings, not replacing them. But one exception is a damaged tracery stone supporting one of the stained glass windows. Greg Civils is the mason responsible for carving its 300-kilogram replacement.
It's great to see it coming along so well.
Yeah.
And you've made huge progress. How long have you been working on this already?
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
These particular areas here are going to have a kind of leafy carved finish.
So lovely, which you'll do.
Yeah, I'll do the whole thing.
Fantastic.
So this is going to take me a little while.
Yes. What do you estimate? You've done it 2 weeks already.
Yeah,
so.
I'm thinking hopefully in another 3 weeks.
So you're obviously a real perfectionist, though.
Well,
you must be. I mean, look at these. They're so beautifully done and rounded.
This is it. I mean, the craftsmanship of the original is its high standard. Mm. And, you know, in those days, they had a lot of time. And they had a lot of passion for what they were doing.
Yeah.
I think they probably had quite a lot of, you know, religious maybe aspects to their work, you know.
Yes, so they felt they were doing it for God or something.
Yeah, perhaps, yeah. The only difference is that I'm using tungsten to cut the stone.
Right.
In those days, it would have been just sharpened steel.
Right.
You know.
You must get terribly achy hands with all that vibrating.
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of the conception, it's quite romantic to be able to be a stonemason carving all this stuff, but in reality, it is very, very hard work. Mm. You're often out in the open, you know, in the elements, it's cold, and yeah, I mean, my hands are quite sore, even though I've been doing this for 15 years.
Yes.
You know, at times you just get very cramped hands and you get...
Slip and hit yourself.
Well, no, it's just wear, you know, the chisel resting on that part of your... your thumb, and you get a different size thumb.
Oh, really?
you can
tell a stonemason.
Yeah.
But worth it.
It is. It's very satisfying. Good. Very satisfying when you can create something and stand back and think, well, that's going to be there for I don't know how many years. It'll be long here when I'm gone.
Exactly.
And that's a nice feeling.
That is a great feeling, isn't it? When you look up at that east window, you'll be able to think, I did that.
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, fantastic.
During the original 15th century construction process, there would have been several specialist masons like Greg working at Rosslyn. But the sad fact is, we don't even know their names. The only clues to their identities are the strange so-called mason's marks on the stones. They've often been thought of as something mysterious or secretive, but in fact, they're really a bit like a painter's signature. They're just the personal marks cut by individual masons to identify the work they'd done, to make sure they got paid for it. The conservation team has noticed that a few of the masons' marks resemble those from a nearby ruined monastery. Melrose Abbey is only 30 miles from Rosslyn, and Sir William would certainly have come here. Dr. Richard Fawcett, the Principal Inspector of Ancient Monuments for Historic Scotland, has agreed to show me round. During the Reformation, Protestant mobs destroyed many of the stone carvings, but scattered about are nearly 100 that survived.
It really must have been one of the most impressive churches ever built in Scotland. In fact, one of the most impressive churches ever built in Britain. What I find rather exciting about this part of the church is that you get a very good indication of the change of attitudes to architectural design that you're getting in the later Middle Ages in Scotland. In the very earliest part, you have a very English building, and you see that best of all in that very rectilinear tracery.
Yes.
It looks almost as if it was designed on a piece of graph paper. Mm. But then there's a great change in the window that you can see just there. You can probably see that that's designed in a much more flowing
way.
Yes,
it is, isn't it? So what do you think were the influences for the change there?
It is rather intriguing because it's a sort of design that when you first look at it, you might think that it's harking back to old and abandoned mm-hmm. English types of tracery design. But that sort of design was being taken up on the continent in the very late 14th century. And in fact, here at Melrose, we're particularly fortunate that we have an inscription over there which says that there was a French-born mason called John Morrow at work here. And I think it's pretty much certain that he was responsible for the change in the design of the window tracery.
How interesting. So that you feel there's a bit of a French influence on this?
I think it's actually built by a French mason. Oh. And the rather nice thing about John Morrow is that he was no shrinking violet when it came to making claims for what he'd done. And on the inscription there, he very carefully lists some of the other buildings that he'd worked on. So you can see, John Morrow sometime call it was I, and born in Paris certain lie, and had in keeping all mason work of St. Andrews, ye high kirk of Glasgow, Melrose, and Pasley. And you can see then goes on to Nidisdale, which is probably Lincluden. So I think we have to be very, very grateful indeed to him.
Absolutely.
That he was prepared.
That's a wonderful record.
Yes. If only more medieval architects were quite so arrogant, we'd have a much fuller record of what it was that they did. Mm. You can see that this was the original outside wall of the church that was started in 1385.
Oh, yes.
When John Morrow came along, he decided to add this row of chapels on the outside. This sort of row of chapels on one side of the nave is something you find in quite a lot of continental Cistercian houses. So I think
so
it's John Morrow bringing the idea
influence.
Over. What's so exciting is that he must have been one of the main channels by which these French ideas were introduced into Scotland. And I think what we then see at Rosslyn some decades later is a mason who was trying to reflect these French ideas without quite understanding them, it has to be said. And I think what we find at Rosslyn is an attempt to produce a building with something of the cosmopolitan French veneer by somebody who only was aware of these things at second hand.
Oh, well, that's very interesting. So they sort of went for rather an overabundance of some of the French
yes, yes.
Features.
You almost get the feeling in parts of Rosslyn that they didn't know when to stop.
There are a lot of similarities here with Rosslyn Chapel. At the top of the abbey, I even find a carved green man.
Oh, look at that. There's one of your green men.
Yes, yes.
So it's really nice and to see some of these little details here. This is very reminiscent of some of the carving we have at Rosslyn.
Absolutely, except that at Rosslyn you have an awful lot of it piled on.
We certainly do.
Carving piled on,
yes.
Carving.
And these great gargoyles here.
Yeah. But you can see the famous pig over there.
Where is he?
Over there.
Oh, yes, I see. Yes, we've heard it. I've heard so much about him.
Yes.
He's the pig with the bagpipes.
Yes,
I'm fascinated by Richard's belief that a French stonemason was responsible for many of the carvings at Melrose Abbey. A French influence on the construction of Rosslyn Chapel is also certainly plausible, as the St. Clair family originated in Normandy. And that's where I'm heading next, to the birthplace of the St. Clairs. It was from here, just 30 miles to the northwest of Paris, in the town of Saint-Clair-sur-Epte, that Sir William's Norman ancestors took their surname.
This unassuming stone tablet marks the beginnings of Normandy. Because, as it says, in 911, in Saint-Clair-sur-Epte, was concluded the treaty which established in France Rollo and the Normans.
During the late 9th century, this area was frequently invaded by Scandinavian Norsemen. In the year 911, after decades of fighting, the French king signed an agreement with Sir William's ancestor, the Viking leader Rollo, creating the province of Normandy and making Rollo the first duke. Rollo went on to make the city of Rouen the capital of his newly formed province. Over the next century, a new, ornate style of architecture developed that was eventually given the name of Gothic. In 1063, Rouen Cathedral was completed, a classic example of this new architecture.
Two of the most striking characteristics of Gothic church architecture are the tall pointed windows and arches and the ribbed vaulting across the ceilings. In fact, in France, another name for Gothic is le style ogival, ogive being a rib. And the point of these two features is that they draw our eyes up towards the heavens to remind us of the power and importance of God.
And there's even more for me here than the Gothic architecture. The cathedral is the final resting place of the great St. Clair ancestor himself.
This is quite special because this is the resting place of Rollo, from whom the St. Clair family is descended. Rollo is the son of Ronvald the Mighty, chief of the Orkneys, and he was made the first Duke of Normandy in the 10th century. So it's quite possible that Sir William St. Clair, when visiting Normandy, would have come to this place, and you can imagine how he would have been inspired by this wonderful architecture.
400 years after Rollo's death, Gothic architecture was at its height. 15th century French masons had a reputation as being among the very best in the world. It was just at this time that the young Frenchman, John Morrow, started his stonemasonry training in Paris. He would have trained first as an apprentice, then travelled from site to site as a journeyman. Then, perhaps after a decade, he would acquire the skills and experience necessary to become a master mason. The craft of stonemasonry is still taken very seriously in France, and the tradition of stonemasonry schools continues today. In Normandy, a master mason, Philippe Giraud, regularly works on 15th century manor houses made of stone. He also runs a masonry school for up-and-coming apprentices. To give me an idea of how the medieval masons would have worked, Philippe has offered to carve a green man from a photograph I took at Melrose Abbey.
Il ne faut pas mettre de l'art gothique dans de l'art roman. Travailler l'art roman, c'est quelque chose de... il faut savoir faire quelque chose d'un petit peu rustique, un petit peu maladroit. Et quand on travaille du gothique, gothique flamboyant, il faut être très précis. C'est un peu comme un musicien qui doit interpréter la musique. La musique médiévale, il doit l'interpréter avec des instruments et avec une expression, et la musique romantique avec d'autres instruments. Nous, on peut changer les outils aussi en fonction des époques, il y a d'autres outils. Alors, évidemment, l'outil que j'ai dans la main, c'est un outil qui est apparu vers le 14e, peut-être le 13e siècle. Alors, au tout début, c'est quelque chose qui n'est pas très facile à faire, ça. C'est un outil avec des petits pics très fins qu'il n'est pas facile de forger. Mmh. Alors, c'est là où on peut mettre toute un deuxième niveau d'expression au niveau du détail.
It's tempting to speculate how similar Philippe might be to Melrose Abbey's 15th century French mason John Morrow. He has impressive masonry skills, an artistic vision, and a great love of stonework, all attributes that I assume must also have applied to John Morrow. The ability of French stonemasons to produce such incredibly fine carvings would certainly have caught the eye of the founder of Rosslyn Chapel, Sir William St. Clair. In 1434, he escorted the Scottish king's daughter Margaret to the city of Tours, just south of Normandy, to be married to the future king of France, Louis XI, here at Tours Cathedral. Sir William's future wife, Elizabeth, also had strong links with Tours. Her father, the powerful 4th Earl of Douglas, had been created the first Duke of Touraine for his support of France against the English. Douglas was a great patron of stonemasonry in Scotland, with close connections to Melrose Abbey. And it's highly likely that it was he who took the French mason, John Morrow, over to Scotland. We'll probably never know for sure, but it's certainly possible that it was here, at Tours, that William St. Clair met Elizabeth Douglas, who was to become his wife. And it's surely no coincidence that there are so many architectural features here that remind me of Rosslyn Chapel.
Those wonderful flying buttresses are just such a majestic example of flamboyant Gothic architecture. It's really easy to imagine how Sir William St. Clair might have been inspired to follow in his father-in-law's footsteps and become a patron of architectural arts in Scotland.
So maybe we're close to solving a mystery, the identity of the stonemasons of Rosslyn. If Sir William knew the Gothic cathedrals of northern France and married Elizabeth Douglas, could he also have used her father's master mason, Morrow, or perhaps his apprentices, to create his own unique chapel here at Rosslyn? On my return from Tours, I find carvings that have a connection to France that I've never noticed before.
I've spent so much time at Rosslyn Chapel, but it's wonderful when something happens that makes you see things with new eyes. And my trip to France did exactly that. I have now noticed that on the coat of arms of Elizabeth Douglas, Sir William Sinclair's first wife, there are three fleurs-de-lis. The fleur-de-lis is the emblem of Touraine and appears everywhere at Tours Cathedral. And that really suggests that there is a link between Touraine and Rosslyn. And another thing that I've noticed, which I'd never seen before, is that whilst I'd thought that all these were angels here, there is one with no wings. And she's a beautiful lady holding a rosary. And I just wonder whether it might be a carved portrait of Sir William's first wife, Elizabeth Douglas. It's a lovely thought.
After all, I do feel a certain connection to her, as we both married into the Sinclair family. While I was away in Normandy, the conservation work on the chapel continued, and I'm thrilled to see that the new lead roof is nearly complete.
Okay. It's so exciting to be up here watching the final part of the process of putting the lead covering on top of the chapel roof. Because once this is done, we can then take off the canopy, which has been shielding the chapel for over a decade.
After 3 weeks, the 300-kilogram tracery stone Greg was carving is now 100 kilograms lighter and is slotted into the east window.
No, it's too much.
Too much.
Just 10 mil.
So one.
That's it.
Yep.
You know, it's all fitting and lining up really nicely there. And it's really nice to see this lined up perfectly.
And finally, after 13 years of covering the chapel, the canopy starts to come down. At last, the moment I've been waiting for. My first glimpse of the outside of the chapel without the canopy. It's Sunday, and everyone in Rosslyn has come to witness the first service for ages without the scaffolding inside the chapel. It's an important moment for the building, the congregation, and my family, especially for my husband, the 7th Earl of Rosslyn, a direct descendant of the chapel's founder. It's wonderful to experience the stone carvings again as Sir William St. Clair intended, as part of the religious fabric of the building, accompanied by hymns and prayers. It was so exciting to hear the chapel bells ringing out this morning for the service for the first time in 13 years, and then to walk into the chapel and see the ceiling revealed in all its glory. There was a buzz about the whole service, in fact, because it really feels as though the chapel is coming back to life. However outlandish some of the theories about Rosslyn might be, the remarkable truth is that over 500 years ago, the most talented craftsmen in Europe found their way to this corner of Scotland to create some of the finest religious carvings in the world. The original purpose of these largely unknown artists was to celebrate the glory of God. But their enduring legacy over the ages has been to create this astounding treasure in stone. A masterpiece to fire the imagination for generations to come.